I'll tell you a bit my story. So I've been, so I'm from France. I know I look maybe Chinese a little bit, but actually from Europe. I've been working with startups for about 10 years. I lived in different countries, in Japan, Korea, China, a bit in Singapore, Malaysia, a bit in the US as well, mostly working with startups. And more recently, I started to focus on hardware startups, so startups making innovative physical products. And the talk I want to give today is sharing why I think hardware is eating the world. So I want to start with a little story. So a long time ago, at the court of a Chinese emperor, the emperor one day decides to call his favorite painter to ask him a question. So the painter comes, and the emperor asks him, I want to know what is the easiest thing to paint and what's the most difficult. So the painter thinks for a minute, then answers, Well, Your Highness, I think the easiest thing to paint is a demon. And the most difficult is a dog. So the emperor is surprised, like, how is that possible? Like, to paint a demon, you need to be very creative. You need a lot of imagination. You need, you know, something colorful and frightening. But the dog is so simple. Everyone has seen a dog. He said, well, the painter answers then, well, precisely. You paint a demon, I paint a demon, somebody else paints a demon. There will be some variation in techniques, in style, but nobody can tell you your demon is wrong, because nobody's seen one. Whereas a dog, anyone paints a demon, anyone can tell if the dog is right or wrong. And I'd like to use this metaphor to think about what we think about innovation. Very often, when we think of innovation, innovative products, or the future, we think of things like that. A jetpack, for instance. People still waiting for them. And this is typical of the thinking that something spectacular is the future, whereas something mundane and innocuous, but actually useful in daily life, like a dog, is not the future. So that prevents us from seeing the future that is actually happening right before our eyes. So it really prevents us of paying attention to the right places. Maybe some of you have seen this video. So try to count how many passes the team in white makes. Let's start. So the team in white, 1, 2, 3. Counting the passes. All right. How many? 8? Maybe, but have you seen, right in the middle of the picture, the moonwalking bear? You want to see it again? So there's a moonwalking bear right in the middle of the picture that we don't see. So, I have a strange bear on the side as well. So when we focus on something that prevents us of seeing what's actually happening right before our eyes, because our attention is not open enough. What's interesting as well is to realize that the world is, the meaning of words is shifting right before our eyes. So this is a picture of the sun, and that used to define light. When the sun was up, there was light. When it was down, no light. Very simple, so, like maybe 100,000 years ago, a long time ago, that was light. About 2,000 years ago, people started to make candles. And suddenly, the light you could take with you. Of course, it had drawbacks. It was a bit dangerous, potentially toxic, had some cost. But suddenly, light was not constrained to time. You could have light whenever you wanted. About 100 years ago, light bulbs came about. And that's still light. But our assumptions around light have changed. But the word is still the same. And this is light as you can buy today. This is, a technical word, is an addressable RGB LED strip, which is basically diodes that you can control. And you could imagine connecting them to sensors, the internet, so that you could have light in different colors reacting to the environment or to your presence. This is light today. some other words have shifted in meaning as well. Who would have expected that to take a picture, you would actually use a phone? I don't know how many phone calls you make in a week compared to the number of messages, number of apps, or the number of websites you read, but this is still called a phone. Here's a picture of a baby who's trying to shift a picture on a magazine by touching it. For this baby, a magazine is a broken touchscreen. The words are the same, but the reality has shifted. This is innovation happening right before our eyes. So innovation is somewhere in between the imagination we have with the future, with science fiction, movies like Iron Man, and some mundane innovation transforming the objects we use in daily life. So the words have shifted in meaning, and there's a quiet revolution underway, the way things are, but there's also a shift in the way things are made. And that's the second part I want to share with you. Some of you in industry have probably heard about lean manufacturing. So it's a method that has been developed by Toyota quite a while ago to basically reduce defects and problems in manufacturing. So the target is to eliminate waste, muda in Japanese. There's all sorts of waste, such as defects, overproduction, waiting time, transport, inventory, motion, all sorts of wastes. This has given birth to other methods, such as ways to identify problems. One method is called the five whys. You ask why consecutively until you find the root cause of a problem. In Japanese, saihatsuboshi taisaku. You find the root cause so that you can fix it forever. So a friend of mine actually works at the Toyota Technical Center in Nagoya, the big Toyota headquarters. And one day, a new manager moved in this division, and the manager decided to interview all the staff to get to know them. And after one of the interviews, a female staff walking out of the office tripped in the carpet and strained her ankle. Shortly after, the manager got a phone call from another division, Toyota, inquiring about the problem. So they asked him, okay, what happened? He said, well, this staff strained her ankle. Then they asked her, why? He said, well, she bumped into the carpet. He said, why did she trip into the carpet? He said, well, there was a little bump, and she didn't see it, she tripped. Why was there a bump in your carpet in your office? Then the guy started to feel a bit nervous, was like, oh, well, I just moved in, and I saw that, but I didn't have really time to fix it, so it became very apparent that it hadn't paid attention to this potential source of problem. As a kind of punishment, and also to hammer the lesson, this manager, every week, had to check the level of his carpet in his office. Every week. This practice from lean manufacturing, looking for defects, moved from industry to management through companies like Motorola, GE, who developed what they called Six Sigma. And more recently, it moved into the world of startups under the name Lean Startup, with those two people, Steve Blank and Eric Ries, who tried to find a way to apply those methods to startup development. First method is to get to know your customers, understand the problem. If you understand deeply the problem, solutions come more easily, and you don't build something people don't want, which is the biggest waste you can have. Second is following this cycle of building, measuring if it's working, and learning from it so that you can continue building in cycles. In our organization in Shenzhen, we try to help startups in the hardware field making physical product and apply what has been learned from software and industry to hardware. It's a very similar approach at the beginning. Validate the problem, understand it deeply, and offer something much better or different, because people are unlikely to shift unless you have something much better. Second, the world of prototyping has changed. Those of you more technically inclined might have heard of Arduino, Raspberry Pi, Spark, the fact that everything is connected through smartphones, through Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, to the cloud, and that now with 3D printing, you can create objects very easily that you can put in the hands of people to see what they say. And this has really given birth to an entire movement called the maker movement, where people build things. Most of them stay at the stage where they build one or just a few things, but some try to make it bigger, and that's what we try to help with in Shenzhen. The third is manufacturing. So what has changed is that before, manufacturing was reserved to big companies, very large companies. Otherwise, factories wouldn't pick up your phone calls. But today, in Shenzhen in particular, you have access to not only all the components you need, but it's also affordable, it's scalable, and it's accessible to startup. Because now factories are willing and eager to work with startups. The fourth step on the challenge here is getting to market. How do you get a lot of people to use the products you create? And this used to be through retail, and was really difficult and had a lot of constraints. But now there's a first step that's possible at a much easier way. It's called crowdfunding. Some of you might have heard of Kickstarter, Indiegogo, where basically you can show the project you're working on and get early supporters to basically back you on buy it before it even exists. So this is a way we also use in our company. Over $1 billion have been already allocated to projects through those sites. The challenge is right after that, and it's still unsolved, is how do you cross what we call the bridge of death when you already satisfied your backers with crowdfunding and you're not yet into retail. And that's a challenge we're working on. So the things I'm most excited about in future products is those three: low-cost robotics, smarter homes, and awareness technologies. Before, robots were confined into factories, very expensive, or very simplistic in the home, or only if you're Tony Stark. But today, robots are low-cost, can come into your desktop, in your lab, or your workshop, and in your home. Yet, the question remains, should we build it if we can't build it? So the question is not anymore, can it be made, but really, is it worthwhile? I'll give you some examples I like. So this is an example. It's probably worthwhile as a performance. It's Mr. Kawakami is the founder of the Chindogu movement, which is creating very efficient solutions to particular problems in such an awkward way that it cannot be commercialized. That's another one. Could replace a cleaning robot in the house, arguably. Some other examples. This box closes itself. This robot solves Rubik's Cube. And the last one plays Flappy Bird. A particular favorite of mine, the smart trash can, catches your trash. Still a prototype, catches 1 out of 10. So don't count on it to clean your room. So I think the future is really lying somewhere between enchanted objects that can really help us and make our lives better, and cursed ones. And as individuals, our challenge is to figure out which ones are enchanted and which ones are cursed. And you could think of it the same way as you think about food. As we get educated more about food, we know what's junk food, and we know what's healthy food. We know that there might be little correlation between the appearance of the food, the taste of the food, and the nutritional value or the healthiness of this food. So I want us to basically build some awareness and immune system so we can recognize that also with innovation and objects. Because at the end of the day, what those objects are is really up to us. I'll close with this phrase, what is it? It's up to us. Thank you.